Apple released the most powerful Mac when they announced the Mac Studio 12 months ago. Powered by the M1 Max and the M1 Ultra, its power and efficiency eclipsed both old and Macs new, including the Mac Pro. But earlier this year, Apple updated the MacBook Pro with a faster, more efficient M2 processor. That's really pushing what is even achievable in computing and battery life. Now, with many rumors that the Mac Studio may or may not get the M2, depending on what day of the week it is, I really started wondering myself if I had made the wrong decision. Should I not have bought the Mac Studio? Should I maybe consider selling my Mac Studio and buying a MacBook Pro? And are there people like me who would be better off buying the MacBook Pro? Well, that is what I plan to talk about today in my long-term review of the M1 Ultra Mac Studio, where we'll explore the good, the bad, the ugly, the weaknesses of the Mac Studio to determine whether or not it is worth purchasing the Mac Studio. Let's get started. Hello again, everyone. My name is Mike Caputo, and today we're reviewing the Mac Studio after 12 months of ownership. Now, to be truthful, I don't even know how we got here because the last time that I talked to you about a Mac Studio, I was returning it.
I don't know if I would keep the version that I have here, the M1 Ultra, and I don't know if I would get the M1 Max.
Wow, that is embarrassing. So needless to say, I have some explaining to do. Now, since this is a long-term review, I'm not going to wholesale regurgitate the specs from Apple's website. That's not helpful to you, nor is it entertaining. Instead, my long-term review is going to be based on 12 months of daily usage covering a variety of use cases. Now, on that note, if you like watching long-term reviews of Apple products, consider subscribing because that is my jam. Now, the Mac Studio has a unique value proposition compared to other Apple computers that are in the lineup. It bridges the pricing and performance gap between the budget-friendly Mac Mini on the low end, whose compact stature delivers a disproportionate performance for its size, and the fully customizable Mac Pro, whose flexibility is really only rivaled by its near infinite cost. But what makes this closely packed hunk of aluminum and silicon so lustworthy? Well, I think the answer starts with design. Now, the design and materials of the Mac Studio make it one of the best looking products in the lineup. It's squatty, it's thick with two C's, and man, it looks mean on your desk, I'm gonna tell you that. Now, it is recognizable with modern design cues that are synonymous with Apple, and in true Apple fashion, the Mac Studio is a rounded rectangle 2.5 times the size of the Mac Mini. And with more ports than a user could ever even ask for, the Mac Studio has broad applicability to enthusiasts and creative professionals alike, including myself. Now, the sleek all-aluminum design exudes a real premium look and feel, but that is only half the story. The Mac Studio is powerful enough to handle the most demanding workloads, and you can configure the Mac Studio with enough storage really to ensure that you're never gonna run out of space. But by far the most impressive feature is the abundant number of ports on it. Gone are the days of needing hubs or adapters to bridge your computer to various different peripherals. With several USB-C and USB-A ports, an HDMI port, an SD card port, a headset jack, and all the connectivity that you could even ask for is right at your fingerprints. The Mac Studio is a pro machine that Apple designed for pro users with complex workflows. Arguably, their workflows are going to be more complex than my own. Now, that doesn't mean the Mac Studio is out of place on my desk, and I don't think it's going to be out of place on your desk. After using the device for the past 12 months, it has proven to be a well-built machine that is immensely powerful. With a premium look and feel to match, it is a reliable choice for creatives and professionals, and even enthusiasts. Now, if you're anything like me, I plug and unplug various different things into my computer all the time. I unplug my monitors and plug them into a different computer all the time. And the anodized finish looks as good as new with no noticeable scratches or dents, even in the high touch areas like on the back of the ports. It really has a clean and minimalistic vibe. It's modern and it's unmistakably Apple. The Mac Studio is uniquely positioned in the Mac lineup. It has more power and expandability than the smaller, less expensive Mac Mini while being more portable and affordable than the Mac Pro. This sets the Mac Studio apart in making an attractive choice for those who value aesthetics and performance in their desktop setup. Now let's talk configurations, because one part of the story is going to be, you know, what does it look like? Second part is gonna be all the ports that are available on it. And the other part is gonna be the internals, all the performance, what is available in the Mac Studio, because it is a beast. It is always ready to pounce, because the configuration is really going to determine whether or not it's gonna be a good value for you. Now, I have the M1 Ultra Mac Studio. I opted to get the 48 core GPU. I have a 64 gigs of unified memory. I did not want to get the 128 gigs of unified memory. I found zero value in that, and I didn't think I was going to benefit from it. Good thing I did not. But I do have 4 terabytes of internal storage because I use this computer for everything. I use it for everything from like general purpose computing, accounting, video editing, audio editing, motion graphics. Right now you can see here from this camera, I'm actually recording the video here live on my computer through an HDMI out on my camera. So it allows me to pull that footage in quickly. I can use it also as kind of a confidence check when I'm recording as well. But this gives me the ability to do all that. Now, I have about 88% of my resources free with this workflow. Now, there'll be times where I might pull all the footage in and it's creating optimized media because the way the footage is created with a multicam clip, it does take a little bit of time to kind of massage and make it, digestible by the computer. You'll see the GPU spike to about 85-90%, but it's there for like a minute or two and then it comes back down and you're able to use the computer again. Otherwise, it's a little bit clunky when you're trying to use the mouse and any of the UI elements. But it is a very powerful computer. Now, if I was thinking about who would benefit from this computer, now I would tell you that if you're watching this video and you're thinking about getting, you know, the M2 MacBook Pro, maybe even the M1 MacBook Pro, because you can find it on sale, versus the Mac Studio, I would say that you're probably better off with the M1 MacBook Pro. And I actually think that if I were to go back in time and see myself from a year ago, like, hey, Mike, guess what? I would tell you that, or I would tell myself, not you, I would tell myself, you really want to rethink what computer you're going to buy and what the specs are going to be, because I upgraded my computers at different times. I have this Mac Studio with M1 Ultra, I have a MacBook Pro with M1 Max, and I have a Mac Mini with M2 Pro as well. And I mean, kind of realistically, they all perform very similarly. The M2 Pro and the Mac Mini is, you know, kind of bottom of those three, but the M1 Max and the M1 Ultra really perform very, very similarly in terms of render times, output times, whether you're doing H.264, H.265, ProRes, they're all very, very close. They're within a, you know, there's maybe 15 or 20 seconds difference between them. Sometimes it's the MacBook Pro, sometimes it's the Mac Studio. But because of that, I probably would have been better served with the M1 Max. And that's what I would tell you is if you were thinking about buying this machine today, whether it's gonna be the MacBook Pro M2 or maybe the M2 Mac Studio, you know, those computers are really gonna perform the same. There's not gonna be a tremendous amount of difference with a quote unquote basic workflow. You're editing 4K, if you're editing audio, you know, podcasting, things like that, you are gonna be certainly fine with the M1 Max. Don't make the same mistake I did with the M1 Ultra, because it's really not gonna be worth it for a majority of you that are out there watching this video. Really, there's gonna be a few people who benefit from the Ultra. I probably just made the wrong choice, you know, just very plainly, made the wrong choice and bought the M1 Ultra when I should not have. I probably could have saved myself about $1,000 opposed to that because of the way that I spec'd it out. But I don't necessarily regret it. I do think that the Mac Studio, I mean, it's a great computer and I love the port availability that it offers. And you really can't get that anywhere else unless you were to buy a dock, buy a hub, and I really just don't want all that stuff on my desk. I actually have too much stuff on my desk. I'm trying to get rid of it. So I am pleased with the performance of the M1 Ultra. My workflow is underutilized with this processor, but I appreciate all of the port and availability, and it gives the actually giving me room to grow into this computer because I do plan to keep it for probably the next, again, 4 to 5 years. But I want to know what you think. Are you more interested in the M2 MacBook Pro, M1 MacBook Pro, or even the Mac Studio? Let me know down in the comments below. I really hope Apple updates this at WWDC in a few months, maybe. Is it a few months from now? My name is Mike, and I will talk to you in the next one.